Welcome to Afternoon Chat. Thanks for joining us. Would you like to introduce yourself to my listeners, kind of explain who you are?
Certainly, yes. I'm Phil Harding. I'm a freelance producer. I'm also a guest lecturer at a lot of universities around the UK. And I'm co-chair of an organisation called James, which is a music industry organisation that gives accreditation to university courses. I've been in the music industry all of my life, since I was 16. So I went straight from school to a studio called the Marquee Studios behind the famous Marquee Club in Soho, Wardour Street in London. And that was 1973, Dutch. And I did my training there, basically an unofficial apprenticeship program. And by the late 70s, I was engineering with clients, working with people like The Clash, Killing Joke, Toya Wilcox. And some point there during the late 70s, into the early 80s, I did a lot of work with Pete Waterman before he formed up with Stock and Aitken, become Stock Aitken Waterman. And in 1984-85, I moved to the PWL Hit Factory that they just started. I was their chief engineer. So from 85 right through to 92, I was involved in a lot of those acts that we had at PWL at the time. So that Rick Astley, Kylie Minogue, Jason Donovan, Bananarama, huge list.
And yeah, I was mainly some classic pop names there. Absolute classics.
Yeah, absolutely. I was mainly the chief engineer, the mix engineer, and formed a production partnership with a guy called Ian Curno, who'd been a friend of mine for a long time, fantastic keyboard player and musician and programmer and producer. And we became the kind of SAW B team, producing some Rick Astley tracks, did a couple of things with Kylie, and a lot of external acts that we used to remix for, like the Pet Shop Boys, Jesus Jones, sorts of names. Yeah.
Yes.
And finally, in 92, we left PWL and started our own studio called Peony Music at the Strongroom Studios in Shoreditch in London. And we then produced a lot of boy bands throughout the 90s. We became known as boy band producers. We worked with E17, Boyzone, 911, a long list. And at the end of the 90s, I kind of got introduced to education through being invited up to LIPA in Liverpool, the McCartney-funded performing arts college there. And that's when I did my first workshop for students and realised that actually it's very useful for industry people, and I'm talking about in any walk of life, really, and different subjects. It's very useful to have industry people come in to talk to students doing undergraduate courses and master's courses at universities. And that was my first experience of that, 98-99. And I've been involved in education ever since. Never full-time. I've always balanced an industry job, carrying on working in my own studio and other people's studios like yours, Dutch, and balancing that between various roles in education. And finally, in 2014, I was invited for the second time, actually, by Leeds Beckett University to do a PhD by portfolio. And they allowed me to academically write about the boy bands I worked with in the 90s. It's quite an unusual subject. I graduated from that 2017, so shows that for someone that left school at 16 with five GCSEs, I jumped straight to a doctorate in my late 50s. So it shows it can be done, and I'm now Dr. Phil Harding, and I've had two books out, one called PWL from the Factory Floor. That's about my experiences in the 80s at the PWL studios, and it's kind of an overview or an underview, even, from someone within the team rather than the books that Pete Waterman and Mike Stock have had out. And I just managed to turn my PhD into a new book called Pop Music Production, and that's currently out with the academic publisher Routledge. And it's a cross between an academic reference book for researchers and students. It's also got memoir notes in there from working with those sorts of bands in the 90s. And it's also a kind of a how-to book. A lot of my production and vocal production techniques and mixing techniques are all laid out in the book. And, boy, that brings you up fairly quickly, 1973 to 2020.
That's an impressive CV, Phil. And I would say to my listener, if you are at all connected with music technology, or you know someone in your family that's studying music tech or sound engineering, then both of those books are a real must-have, especially the pop music production. I've got both of those books. And the pop music production, I've been in the business a long time, and I have been, for part of that time, sound engineer and producer, certainly not in the same league as you, Phil. And I learned so much from reading pop music production. There were so many things in that. And it made me go, oh, for goodness sake, yeah, why didn't I think of that? it's obvious, isn't it? For goodness sake.
There you go. There are so many aspects, as you know.
Yes.
One of the big things that changed in the 80s was that music producers went from working on a standard production contract where you got paid a fee and a royalty, and a royalty means that you're getting a share of the sales income. And we went from that to a situation where suddenly we were asked to be in control of the budgets. The record companies kind of handed over budgets to producers, certainly in the pop and dance world, where we would have the whole budget for the record, and very quickly had to learn to become negotiators, administrators, all kinds of things that producers are not generally known for. Mm. And that is still the way now, very much the way it is, isn't it?
How did you feel about that when, because that was a big change. You were pretty much forced to go from being the creative best friend of the artists to effectively becoming their financial manager as well. How did that feel?
It was tricky, because you always had this balance between creativity and commercialism, because you were being paid by the record company or the manager or the publisher. And as you say, you're trying to service, as I like to say, the artist, you know, be the creative friend to the artist and take care of all the technology for them. And suddenly you were more of a person that was balanced in the middle of the two. So quite a tricky balancing act where you're trying to nurture the artist and nurture their creativity and their ideas and so on. But and that's almost kind of one side of your brain. And the other side is continually thinking, well, how commercial is this going to be? Is it going to meet the brief that we've got from the record company, who are basically the client? And is it going to please them? So quite a tricky balance. But I think in the pop world, we very much experienced a situation from the 80s onwards where, certainly in my experience with a lot of manufactured pop, the PWL and the boy bands, you'd really only see the artists in the studio for vocal sessions. And they'd be so busy with their promotional schedules, 7 days a week.
Yes.
That they didn't have time to come back in the studio and see how the record was progressing, see how the mix was going.
Yeah.
Very rare in my experience across those two decades that an artist would actually turn up and sit down at the back of the studio and want to listen to the mix. And it was quite a shock when, one of the first times that Kylie did that back in the 80s, when by her third and fourth album at PWL, she was wanting to get more and more in control of her career, her image, and then her sound as well. And having spent, you know, a good couple of years working on mixes for her first and second albums, it's quite a shock to be told by people to, oh, Kylie's coming in this afternoon, she wants to hear the mix, Phil. You know, make sure we're in good shape. And in she would walk. So it was quite, moments like that could be quite harrowing. It takes me all the way back to, you know, when I was at the Marquee as an assistant, and as an assistant engineer. You know, you're the runner, you're the T-boy, you're the gopher.
It's got the T-shirt, done that job, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
A lot of things that happened at the Marquee while I was training in the mid-70s were sessions like mixing Elton John album. And I'm currently reading the the Elton John book that's out, and it's a much better account than the film. the Rocketman film, I don't know if you've seen it, but it's very flexible with what actually happened in the timeline and the people involved. But
I've heard that from a number of quarters, kind of saying, well, you know, it's good entertainment, but it's a little bit divorced from reality.
Exactly. It was entertainment first, but no kind of documentary type facts or following the timeline. But in Elton's book, it's called Me, I think, isn't it? You know, he does talk very candidly about, as a lot of artists did in the 70s, that they would record overseas for tax purposes, because tax was so high at certain points in the 70s. You know, 90% of your earnings, if you're Elton John or in the Rolling Stones. So you had all these advisors saying, well, be out of the country. You've only got 2 or 3 months when you can be in the country. So he used to record his albums in France and then America. And I specifically remember we mixed the whole of the Captain Fantastic and the Dirt Brown Cowboy album, which is a classic album from Elton after Yellow Brick Road and those albums. But yeah. So it was all recorded in America, and then the producer Gus Dudgeon would bring it into the marquee.
Wow.
And spend months mixing it. You know,
yeah.
spend a lot longer mixing than I would move on to do. So we'd be 3 or 4 days on a track, things like that. We've no sign of Elton whatsoever. It's actually a concept album, is the way that Elton John and Bernie saw it.
The production is phenomenal. It's outstanding.
It is superb, and the playing and everything.
Yeah.
So we'd finished mixing the album. And what used to happen back then, and it tends not to happen much now, is there would be a playback day when either the artist, you know, the record company management would come in. And as an assistant, I was told, right, tomorrow Elton's coming in to hear the whole album. And you know, it's just first and only time I met him. And an incredible experience, you know, because he hadn't heard anything on the album since the recording sessions.
Mm.
Hadn't popped into the mixing sessions, nothing.
Mm.
Totally trusted his producer, Gus Dudgeon, and the engineer, Phil Dunn, who was one of my mentors. Came in, all he wanted was a cup of tea, made him a tea. He sat down in the sweet spot in the middle of the studio and listened to, well, obviously albums were two sides in those days, so you'd have a reel of tape that would be equivalent to one side of vinyl. So heard the whole of side one, you know, minimal comments, you could see how happy he was, through the whole of side two, and virtually no criticism, no comments, just full of praise and excitement, and
wow.
So happy with what Gus had done. And what that said to me was how fantastic that an artist, especially of Elton John's caliber and, you know, his status at that point, must have been about 75, that could trust his producer and engineer so much with, you know, his songs, his babies, as artists used to call them in those days, you know, to finish the final product that was going to be heard by everybody. And to walk into the studio and have no criticisms and no, oh, redo this or change that, it was incredible. And I still remember that to this day.
It's also a mark of respect for your colleagues. And clearly Elton, you know, when he worked with people, he didn't micromanage. He just surrounded himself with great people and trusted them to do a great job and left them to get on with it.
Good leadership from Gus, as much as people might criticize him. And he looked bad in the film, the manager, John Reed, who also managed Queen. So he was featured in that film as well. But he was a good guiding manager, and Elton was able to pick and choose his musicians and band members. He did have a major change at one point, but then went back to the original lineup. As much as we can see in the film, we can read in the book that his behaviour off the stage and behind the scenes was quite something to behold by his own admission, you know, with his drinking and his drugs and everything. It was still, overall, as an artistic and creative and business model, a very good model for me to learn from. And, and Gus Dudgeon was tremendous mentor to me, not in any deliberate way. This is me just observing him and making an early decision as a sort of late teenager that production's definitely what I want to do, and that's the sort of producer I want to be.
I can think of worse ways of starting in an industry. I mean, wow, what a start. Yeah. Let's hear the title track from that album, just to remind people how good it actually is, and then we'll come back and talk some more.
Okay.
Fantastic, raised and regimented, hardly a hero. Just someone whose mother might know. Very clearly a case for cornflakes and classics. Two teas, both with sugar, please. In the back of an alley. While little dirt cowboys turn brown in their saddles, sweet chocolate biscuits and red rosy apples in summer. For it's hey make and hey ma, do the papers say anything good? All the chances in life for little dirt cowboys. Should I make my way out of my home in the woods? Brown dirt cowboy, still green and growing, city slick captain. Fantastic the feedback, the honey the hive could behold. Children on wheels out the winners, and the 68th summer festival will fly a thin air. We'll be right back.
You forget how good that album is. The title track from Captain Fantastic and the Brown Dirt Cowboy, Elton John. Brilliant, brilliant production. Gus Dudgeon, of course, producer there. And we were just hearing from Phil, his engineering input and a few stories around that. All right, we're going to go straight back to Phil and hear a little bit more about the 80s. Are we going to have a little chat about Rick Astley, do you think?
One of my favourite artists that I've ever worked with, Rick. And a wonderful guy when he arrived at PWL. And there's been these sort of long-held kind of rumours, but it is true, and many of us have substantiated it, that he came as a T-boy. And I don't know if you remember, back in the 80s, we had a YTF scheme,
youth
training scheme, and Pete Waterman persuaded him to leave the band that he was in, that Pete Waterman had spotted him playing up in Warrington, which is where Pete Waterman still has a house and had one for a long time. And set Rick up on this YTF scheme to come and work at the studio. And the idea was, still with Rick's original manager, was, well, look, he's a very young guy. Let's kind of slowly bed him into the idea of being at PWL Studios, getting to know the system there and the people. And we're paying. We're paying via this YTF scheme. So, but of course, the thing was that the only people that Pete Waterman told that he was actually an artist and a songwriter were Mike Stock and Matt Aitken.
Right.
So the rest of us literally did assume
he was the T-boy.
He's the latest T-boy that Pete's probably brought down from up north and doing someone a favour or something.
It was the reverse of the secret boss, wasn't it? It's secret artist masquerading as the T-boy.
Yeah. And of course Rick being very young and quite a shy character, he never said anything he might have said it to possibly one or two of the assistants, but he certainly didn't say it to, you know, engineers and other members of staff like myself. So it would be cup of tea please, Rick, milk, no sugar. And that was how our relationship started off. And then finally, 6 months or so into that, Pete Waterman said to myself and my partner Ian Kerner, and we were running by that point already two studios down in the basement. Ian in a fantastically fitted out creative music programming room with a Fairlight and Roland keyboards and a great system, and myself in the second of the studios that had been built there with an SSL console and really high-level pro equipment. And he said, look, in a bit of downtime, guys, do you think you could sit down with Rick and take a look at his song ideas, you know, get them programmed up for him and knock some songs into shape so that the rest of us can hear them? So we were the first ones to nurture Rick, as it were, and and became very friendly because of that process.
Yeah.
Apart from Ian playing quite a few keyboards on his albums, especially the strings and brass on Never Gonna Give You Up, very prominent and fantastically created by Ian Kerner. And we produced two tracks on that first album, and I did some of the mixes. And on the second album, we in fact produced the two singles, the lead single, She Wants to Dance With Me, and the album title track, Hold Me In Your Arms. And when I got married in 1986, this is how friendly and part of the team Rick was. He had a stag party at my local pub in East London. And I'd got to know the landlord fairly well. And they had a piano and a drum kit and a few bits of equipment in the corner for pub crooners that used to come in. Nothing more than that.
Yeah.
And I said, is there any chance we can have a lock-in, you know, and have my stag party here, you know, with a bit of food and guests and so on. And Rick and a whole bunch of people from the studio came, and we ended up in there till 2 or 3 in the morning with Rick on the drums, because he started as a drummer. As people might know, he's gone back to that a bit. And, you know, well, again, what a fantastic memory. Rick actually playing drums
on your stag night.
In my stag party in a pretty rundown pub in East London. Not many people could say that. So, I haven't seen Rick for a little while. And like a lot of people, very disappointed, I would think, that all of the concerts and festivals and all the rest of it that have been cancelled this year already, planning to see Rick at Newmarket Racecourse where they have gigs. Yes, and look forward to seeing him this year, but I guess that's not going to happen.
It's just hope
that people can survive in that live music industry world and come out of it and come back in a strong way. But I do fear that that some things will fall by the wayside, unfortunately. And
sadly. But let's play Never Gonna Give You Up.
Why not?
Let's have a listen. Let's indulge ourselves. Never Gonna Give You Up. There they were, all the strings and the brass, very prominent, lovely.
Yeah, really wonderful. The reason I point that out is because I did do an early version of that, an early mix of that, before all those strings and brass went on. And I think myself and Mike Stock could tell that there's more to this track to come, but couldn't put our fingers on it at the time. You know, we were very much instructed by Pete to do things at a certain time, and you did the best you could, and that mix is on a compilation CD that I've had out to go alongside my PWL book. Once those strings and brass went on, it just took it to another level, Dutch, that obviously we all know and we're used to, but it's amazing how just a couple of things like that can turn a track around from something that's sounding pretty average, no matter how good the song was, but all production value that pulls everybody in and makes them smile. So, yeah, quite a difference there.
It's become a signature sound, hasn't it? That production style.
Yeah.
The moment you hear it, you think of that era totally.
Yeah, that's right. And there's not a huge amount of PWL product that get played on radio, other than, you know, some of the local radio stations that are doing their oldie shows, Absolute 80s and stations like that. But in terms of national radio like Radio 2, it's quite rare, other than that Rick Astley track and a few Kylie tracks and the occasional Bananarama track. But, you know, by 1989, PWL had either produced and or released 40% of the UK singles market that year. And another strong memory I have is being at an award show in early 1990, and a speech by an American record company executive was almost lambasting his staff in the UK, saying, how can it that the independent company in South London with independent distribution have 40% of the market in a year? You know, what on earth are you guys doing? And it was quite
better
hilarious.
Than you, obviously, came the answer. Better than you, mate.
Yeah, well, clearly. Yeah.
Makes a change, so, though, doesn't it?
Yes. Well, Pete Waterman set out to make PWL the UK version of Tamla Motown in the 60s. And he did a pretty good job of...
I think he succeeded. He succeeded, yeah. Without a doubt, yeah. Because he didn't just leave his mark. He remoulded the British pop industry.
Yeah. Absolutely, and you can see what a great character he is. I don't know if you've seen this recent program on Channel 5 where he's on a barge.
Yeah.
He doesn't really talk about music on that program, no. But his root in industry, he's a huge rail fanatic, but you could see that he's really into the workings and the makings of the boat and the life, the path. He's fascinated by that. And, you know, we were a three-story former electric power station in South London. That was the building we were in. And by the time Pete had finished building, because we built down into the bunker and had a sub bunker as well, so we have four floors of four different studios, offices, all sorts of things, but decorated everywhere with, apart from gold records, train memorabilia, yes. Racing cars.
So we're going to move on now from what you used to do to what you're doing now.
Well, like many producers and engineers, and, you know, people talk about the music industry shrinking and, you know, famous studios closing and all the rest of it. But technology has allowed us, as you know, Dutch, to all have some kind of pro studio set up at home in a small room. You know, it could be a laptop or whatever you base it around. But it's not as expensive to do as it used to be.
No. And thank goodness, because how else would we be carrying on now if we didn't have that technology?
Absolutely, but it's fantastic for the youngsters. You know, I say to students, you're living in a dream world that back in the 80s and 90s, we can only fantasize about.
We had it rough.
But in the 90s, when finally, especially my partner Ian Kerner, finally Steinberg Cubase, who make one of the famous music software sequencers for workstations, finally they said, right, we're going to come off of this Atari computer, which was basically designed as a games computer, and we're going to go to Apple.
The 1040 ST Atari.
Yeah. and we're going to give you, because so many people have been asking for it, we're going to give you MIDI, which is what you compose music in via an electronic piano or keyboard, and audio, which is, you know, when you record the vocals and everything. We're going to give it to you in one program so that all of that is together and editable, which is completely normal now,
yeah.
And easy for anybody to download free programs even on your PC or laptop or whatever. But it was an absolute revolution in the 90s, and the first E17 record we did, House of Love, in 1992, was amongst the first records to make use of that technology, where we took a 112 BPM sort of pop hip-hop track, and at the request of their manager, Tom Watkins, we turned it into a 120 BPM Frankie Goes to Hollywood type of raucous up-tempo sing-along, and that gave them their first hit. And that was amongst the first records where we combined audio and MIDI together to allow us to make that tempo change. And we went on a very good run with E17, three albums we worked on with them, and finally peaked in 1994 with the Christmas number one, Staying Up Day.
Yeah, and great record.
Quite something that Ian and I had progressed from the SAWB team, as I described in the 80s, to the A team, as it were, working for Tom Watkins, previously managed Pet Shop Boys and Bross. We met him around the same time that he signed E17 and just went on this fantastic sort of 3-year run of hit records with them and many others, peaking at that number one. And again, like one of these vivid memories that stays with me, like moments in time, is the day that on the Sunday night chart countdown that we all used to listen to. It's on yes. Fridays now, but yes. records used to climb the charts quite slowly in those days. So it was the week of, you know, what's going to be the Christmas number one, and we were in the top 10 and listening, coming back from London on a Sunday night after a social thing with my wife. And when it got to record number 2 and they still hadn't played the E17 track, we looked at each other and
you knew. Said,
my God, we must be number one.
Yeah.
And I can remember going home. I'd moved to Suffolk in 1987, but was still working in London and had a flat in London. And I remember when we downed tools in 94 for Christmas and turning up at Liverpool Street to get on the train up to Suffolk, thinking, well, you know, no matter what, no one can take away that we finally achieved a UK number one this year. And of course, the great thing about having a hit at Christmas is it comes around every year, as we know. That's always been a nice little learner for
it's
us.
It's the gift that keeps on giving, Christmas
yes,
record.
Yes. But just to sort of wind back way before that, to allow you to play the music I've sent you. At that time I was describing in the late 70s, you know, where I was engineering and working with people like Toy Wilcox, and into the early 80s, believe it or not, I was still toying with the idea of being an artist myself, as well as working towards an engineering and production career. And one of the engineers at the market, he said to me at one point, I really think you've got to decide one thing or the other. You're going to make a go of it with your band, or you're going to make a go of it as an engineer producer. But I can see you're struggling to balance the both, because, you know, I was in this band called the 24 Club for many years. We had some different names. We were kind of a post-punk band. And I used to live with two of the other guys in Romford in Essex. And in spare time, we'd practice and we'd gig. And luckily, I had the facilities to allow us to go into studios and record. We never quite made it. We moved out to America at one point. I got an extended leave of absence for 3 to 6 months. And the band fell apart in America. But
oh dear.
Fantastic friends that I made in the band, Dave Dale and Mick Hansen, who were both still in America. And like a lot of bands from that period, even though we weren't successful in any shape or form, we've had time in our later years, i.e. now, to revisit some of the unreleased tracks that we had. And we released an EP in 2018 called Timeless, hence the title of the track, because we were redoing some songs that were from the early 80s. And this lead track that I've asked you to play, Dutch, Tell Me What You Want, was a kind of a jam from when we had a little get-together back in the early 2000s. And finally, we worked it up and some older tracks. And we're currently working on a new single. But as a complete contrast to what we've generally been talking about in terms of the music genre, this is quite sort of powerful edging on punk pop almost. And this song, Tell Me What You Want, has done pretty well for us with radio play and so on.
Well, let's give it a listen. Here we go.
Thanks, Dutch.
24 Club, Tell Me What You Want.
Take out return. We could live in peace with nothing left to hide. And we could end these wars right now if we decide. So tell me what you want. Tell me what you need. Show me what you've got. I'll show you what I see. Tell me what you want. Tell me what you need. Show me what you've got. I'll show you everything.
Wow, that was different. Tell me what you want, the 24 Club. That is not what I expected to hear, Phil.
That's me on bass with some of those band members, certainly the two that I mentioned, Mick Hanson and Dave Dow. We were in a previous band, I can't remember the name of it, and I was playing keyboards. And I was determined to sort of get away from the keyboards and move around on stage. Yeah. So I said, right, next band, I'll be on bass chats. And a lot of the material we did, that was about 170 BPM, that track you just played. But that was our average speed. And that's, believe you me, that's fast to play that kind of stuff. So we were very fit lads in our early 20s. And playing all that sort of stuff, that punky type stuff, it kind of needs to be, I'm going to get a bit muso now, it kind of needs to be played on downstrokes. You know, anyone that's a guitar player will understand that. You know, if you're going down and up, it's not as aggressive as continually going down. And that was both on the guitars and on the bass. So it was quite something. But, we're working on a new single at the moment. It'll be out later in the year.
Well, will you let me know when that comes out and we'll give that a plug?
Absolutely. But as so many records are made these days in the way I'm about to describe, where one person starts to track off and you put the files up online as stems, and Dale has started this new single in Los Angeles in his studio. I'm about to do my bass overdubs, some backing vocals, and then I'll pass it on to Mick Hanson, who's in Brooklyn, and he'll do more guitars, and then it will all come back to me for mixing. So, and that's how a lot of pop, rock, and dance records are made these days, without people gathering in the studio.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, there's a lot of us on that side of the industry that, thankfully, providing we've got the clients that want us to keep going, we can do the work in isolation.
Well, we are almost out of time, but I want to play another track from the 24 Club for you. This is Face to Face. Some last words before we go?
Yes, well, keep safe, everybody, in rugby. And, you know, let's hope that the music industry and the live circuits and the gigs get back to as they once were, thriving, and look forward to speaking to you again soon. And this is Face to Face 24 Club.
Phil Harding, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Dutch.